This program is presented by University of California Television. Like what you learn? Visit our website or follow us on Facebook and Twitter to keep up with the latest UCTV programs.
Our panel deals with two factors, cost and capacity, and we're going to do it a little differently from the first panel. We will be here staring at you all during our time period, and you may stare at us. So we have a wealth of knowledge and experience on higher education sitting at this table. It's really quite something when you put it all together, not counting myself, the three down that way. People right at the top of the policy world in higher ed. So I'm going to introduce our panelists extremely briefly because you have longer statements in the program booklet. And I will do it in the order in which they will speak, which means I start with Jane Wellman, who is second to my left. Jane has been at the top of the higher ed world, having gotten there by starting at the office of the president, actually having gotten there by starting with a degree from Berkeley, 2 degrees from Berkeley. Then, despite having worked at the office of the president for several years, succeeded, and has went on to be involved at the top of many different commissions and boards, such as the National Commission on Post-Secondary Board Governance, where she was executive director, and NASH, the National Association of System Heads, and many more things. She is now back here, resident in Berkeley. And secondly, second speaker will be Joni Finney, who is sitting immediately to my left. She too has a California background in that she was for many years the vice president of the California and then the National Center for Public Policy and Higher Education in San Jose. And she has moved on to the University of Pennsylvania, where she is director of the Institute for Research on Higher Education there, and also a professor of practice. And third and well to my left is Candice Teal, who is the founder of the Open Learning Initiative, which happened at Carnegie Mellon University. She is now at Stanford, associated on the faculty with the Graduate School of Education, and is a research fellow in the Office of the Vice Provost for Online Learning at Stanford, which suggests to me that she not only thinks and researches about it, but makes it happen. So a wealth of other involvements and a very interesting background coming to an academic career relatively late after lots of other experiences before that. So rather than my taking up more time, let us turn to our speakers, and that would mean we start with Jane.
Thank you, Judd. Well, it's a pleasure to be here. It's although I'm back at Berkeley, it's fairly recently, and I'm not on the campus enough, and I really value it and like it. And being here with Joni and Candace, who I know from different lives, Joni and I have been colleagues. Candace had to endure me as a teacher, and we both learned a lot from that experience. I think I'm getting better at it, but not some. I wanted to really just sort of set the table for a conversation, and so I'll be brief, and I don't have PowerPoint, and I'm going to talk about money. So let me make a few simple points, and we can then unpack them. I think higher education, both public and private, is undergoing a sea change in its finances and its revenue structures. And there is one of the great collisions across the country is a collision between declining revenues and entrenched cost structures and growing student demand, which has led to a real problem of capacity. And too many students are being turned away from college or are being accommodated in institutions that don't have the resources to serve them appropriately. So we've got a money problem and a student access problem and a student success problem, which is fairly significant. The specifics of the problem and how it manifests itself differ between public and nonprofit institutions, and differ again in the public sector between research universities and comprehensive colleges and community colleges. But it's an ecosystem, and we're all swimming in the same ocean, and so there's a more commonality despite those differences than there are real dissimilarities. I'm going to use some examples from California that are somewhat UC-centric and the assumption that that'll work for you. But we can also talk about what it means in a small liberal arts college. The cost problem has got an inside problem and an outside problem. And I'm going to start outside and then go inside. The outside problem, if you will, or the way I'm choosing to define it, has to do with what's happening in public institutions to state revenues and state revenue structures. In California, the economy has fundamentally, and this is true in other states, but you'll see it better if you think of California. The structure of the economy has fundamentally changed, and the number of people who are working for a salary with a predictable income stream relative to wage earners has fundamentally shifted from what it was 30 years ago. And that difference in the economy and in the wage structure shows up in our tax system. The general fund now in California, 60% of the revenues California is a very progressive tax system. The general fund derives almost 60% of its revenues from income taxes. Within the income tax bubble, around 55% of those revenues come from taxpayers making more than $500,000 a year. So just put that on visual and think about the number of the people in the population who are making over $500,000 a year relative to the whole population, and then think about that being more than half of the general fund. And you get some idea of what the shape of the revenue stream looks like. One of the phenomenon from that is that because of the dependence on high wage earner or highly compensated employees, that California is very vulnerable to economic cycles, and particularly to boom and bust cycles that occur in capital gains. It's because these are typically not people who are getting paid a straight salary. They're making bonuses and they're making it. So revenues go like this. If they make a lot of money, they might shelter it. Who knows what Apple's going to do with its employees, et cetera. So you have a general fund that's dependent on high wage earners and whose income is inherently unstable and volatile. That, in combination with economic cycles, means that if you were to chart the general fund in terms of year-to-year growth, you would get something that looks like a nasty, jagged chart of big swings up in good times. California, the revenue structure generates lots of money in good times, tanks in bad times. And the decline in income relative to the consequences on the general fund is very disproportionate. Just as one example, in 2008, in the teeth of the last recession, per capita revenues per $100 personal income declined by 5% from the previous year. They still grew 5%, but they were down from a 10% growth the prior week. So you've got a dip a little bit in revenues from tax from the individual. The general fund declined overall 15%. So you've still got incomes are still going up and taxes are going revenues are going up per capita. General fund goes down 15%. So you've got a very unpredictable, highly volatile general fund structure, and it's going to stay that way. The only way to solve that problem in California and in other states is to increase income taxes on lower-waged employees to get more money from a more stable income revenue source. That ain't happening politically. The other way to do it in California is to challenge Proposition 13 and pull more property taxes back in the general fund, and we can go straight to the cocktail hour on that one. So you've got that. The other thing that's happening in the general fund is a declining percentage of revenues that are available for discretionary purposes. Discretionary purposes being where universities sit in the general fund. And this, the problem of declining discretionary revenues is a problem in every state. It's not confined to California. California is a little bit more vivid, as always, just because so much of the initiative and referendum process and how much of the budget's been carved out because of that. But prior to the passage of Prop 98 in California, discretionary revenues were 60% of spending. They've declined now to below 10% in spending. In the 95 to 2000, I believe, period, discretionary revenues were growing at a lower rate than discretionary spending. We're still growing at about 2-3% per year. They are now declining 2-3% per year. So you've got volatile money, you've got less that's available for universities and for discretionary purposes. And then the third phenomenon, which is that the absolute rate of revenue growth, and this is happening everywhere in the country, has been cut almost in half. Nationwide general tax revenues historically have grown on average around 5%. Over time, they go down in bad times, they come back up, but you can count on 5%. We're now looking at a probability of revenue growth in the neighborhood of more like 2.5-3%. So, you know, from 5 to 3, that's a big number cut. There's a problem of declining growth in revenues. So that's the outside problem. Inside, of course, is looking at the cost structures within universities. There's a structural imbalance in universities in the way that resources are acquired and expended, which is at some level, there's some analogies to the state budget problem. Universities have very high fixed costs, and I'm not just talking about costs of faculty and salaries, I'm talking about costs of employee benefits. Employee benefits in public institutions historically have been more generous than in private institutions, particularly where there's defined benefit programs and in retirement, very high costs for generous healthcare subsidies. Those costs have been growing in California at a rate of 6% per year. So you can't have those kinds of costs growing at that rate. That's your new money, and it comes off the table as the very first thing that happens in the budget process. It is treated as a fixed cost and taken off the table. There's basically a separate budget process for benefits. And so the decision-making process is different. There's other players involved. I won't belabor it all except to say you can't have that much of your new money basically siloed into a separate trough. So you've got a problem of high fixed costs and a budgeting process that protects resources rather than looks at trade-offs or addresses. The second problem or the second challenge gets to more of the topic of this conference, and that is the cost structures that are embedded in the way we think about teaching and learning and how instruction is delivered and in the bundling of costs around faculty and use of faculty time. The several critics of it's sort of axiomatic in higher education that one of the problems of higher education finance is that we're funded on seat time and on credits rather than on student success. I really don't buy that. I think we're funded on positions, and the positions are what are built are what define the cost structures in universities. The formulas that were in place and put in place in the 60s. That haven't been in place for 20 years, but the DNA lives on, believe me. And so those formulas were based on a structure of faculty use and time and cost of discipline and distribution of undergraduate to graduate education that were in place in 1960. And what that means in money terms is that you expect a general education curriculum that's cheap for 2 years. You have a handful of class titles. Lower division education is, on average, about 50% of the cost per unit of the upper division education. Graduate education, professional education is 2-3 times the cost of undergraduate. Doctoral is 4 times. So imagine that cost curve. There's been, and the student attrition, of course, is highest at the levels where we are spending the least on student success. So I think there's something in our cost structures, particularly in a public research university. The privates are not quite as exaggerated in this sense, where we are subsidizing graduate education from cross subsidies from undergraduate education. What that means if we don't have new money is that undergraduates are the first to be denied access. So we could go on a lot more about what the curriculum looks like and why that is part of the cost problem, but it is, until we think about restructuring our cost centers and think about different ways of organizing resources within the institutions, we're going to have trouble with any serious restructuring of costs. I'll finish with a couple of other quick comments. Historically, what's happened in higher education in budget problems is that institutions will cut budgets. They don't restructure costs. I think that that's still, for the most part, true. There's a series of things that are done to bring things back into balance, but we haven't really seriously tackled the whole set of issues around how resources are spent, where the money comes from, where the money goes. In order to do that, I think there's a couple of things we need to be much more thoughtful and self-conscious about in the academy. The first one is that we need to bring conversations about resource use and conversations about student success into the same room. We really do know that there's been so much more done in higher education to think about assessment of learning and student learning, and whether we know that robust teaching and learning has gone on. There's so much more conversation about things like your conversation here, how do we do a better job with student success? Do we ever bring money into that? We just don't. And yet money and the absence of money is always the reason the breaks go on. So we have to be thinking about how do we think about cost effectiveness and how to use resource distribution in a way that animates better student success rather than I'll balance the budget over here and you deal with academic reform over there and we don't talk to one another. The other thing is that we need to be prepared to rethink basic notions of quality as in being terms that are synonymous with quality of faculty. And I don't mean to be pejorative with this, but I think that we have to be thinking about different ways to use faculty and an unbundling of faculty time. We shouldn't be thinking about quality as basically synonymous with money. Quality needs to be thought of in terms of student success and research effectiveness and other kinds of things, and not just revenue maximization. If you think about what's the barrier to restructuring costs in institutions, is it that you don't have enough money, or that you have too much money and therefore there's no incentive to restructure your costs? There's that. Or is it has something to do with culture and our notions of what is and isn't on the table and what's possible to do? And so I want to finish by saying I don't think that we are in a time it is a time of deficit and it's a time of pressure on change. I don't think of this as a bad thing. I realize every time I talk about this, I leave the audience depressed and people furiously looking up to see what their retirement options are. thinking this is like, boy, this isn't looking good. I just think that there is such a thing as a cost-effective curriculum. I think we still have the best financed public university system on the planet in this state. The University of California is still very generously financed. Not going to be the same kind of money it was in the past. It's going to require different kinds of decisions, different kind of leadership. But there's lots of opportunity and more than ever an imperative for some creative and flexible change. Go so I'll Dave. Stop there. All right.
Okay. Oh my goodness. To follow that, but I'm really pleased to be here to Judd and Carol. Thank you. And I have worked with both Jane and Candace in different capacities and enjoy being back with them again. I wanted to talk a little bit about some research that I've done over the past few years about how the finance issues play out in states, and specifically how it relates to performance. And when I went to the University of Pennsylvania in 2008, I initiated a project that looked at, it's called a state review project, but really looked at the relationship between public policies and state performance, and that was state performance in a number of different areas. You know, whether young people are prepared for post-secondary education, whether they in fact enroll in our institutions, whether they progress and complete, whether it's affordable, and the extent to which the state receives some kind of economic and civic benefit from higher education. And we were able, when my previous life, to document state performance fairly well with the data available that we had. And so we were able to document in a report that we called Measuring Up for Over a Decade how well states did in these various areas. What we weren't able to do is explain that performance. You know, how, you know, what were the reasons behind either good performance, bad performance, improvement in performance, or decline in performance. And so when I went to Penn, we looked at a sample of states to try to understand that. We looked at six states. We looked at Georgia, Illinois, Maryland, Texas, and Washington. And then we worked on a book, published a book, and then added California, took a look at California. I thought I would focus primarily on just three of those states today and not California, because I knew that California would be adequately covered in this conference. So, we looked at all kinds of policies and how they related to performance, and certainly governance and the intersection of governance and finance is important. The intersection of accountability and finance is important. But for my remarks today, I really want to focus on finance. And putting this in Jane's terms, my presentation is more about the outside story and how the outside story affects what the state gets in terms of overall performance. So we did extensive case studies, looked at databases across these five states. We had an enormous amount of data. We interviewed 30 to 50 people in every single state. And when I say we, I had a research team, a colleague, Laura Perner, that helped me on this project, and three PhD students. And we visited each state twice and did, you know, a lot of interviews and some interviews over the phone. And we documented all that in what we called a briefing book. And as, you know, those of you familiar with case study research came up with themes that we tested off of a number of people. Jane was on our advisory group, so I get to indict her in this work.
You never listen to my advice.
No, well, that's okay. You know, that's not what you're there for. No. So, but anyway, the states that I think that I'm going to talk about are really interesting contrasts. The one I want to start with is Illinois, and we called our title for Illinois was A Story of Decline. And we have very short case studies, by the way, in a book called The Attainment Agenda that we published, but very long detailed case studies on my website at the University of Pennsylvania. So in 2000, Illinois was one of the top performing states in the country in terms of the opportunity it offered its residents to enroll in post-secondary education at different kinds of institutions at a fairly moderate price with a lot of support in state financial aid. Illinois was organized, and this is where this intersection of governance and finance comes in, as a system of systems. And it was designed by the architect of that was Lyman Glennie, who came from Berkeley, who really helped organize the Illinois system of higher education. And I think for decades it was maybe, you know, coming close to California, of course, one of the most logically organized systems, public systems of higher education in the country. The system of systems did not allow any one type of university sector to dominate the political landscape. They had mixed types of institutions in smaller systems with a very strong coordinating board, with public appointments of highly respected individuals, not individuals just from higher education who would represent interests in higher education, but broad public interests. And that coordinating board had the ear of the governor and the legislature for many years, and they were able to establish policy that made Illinois probably the top performing state in the country in many of our measures of performance. Since that time, Illinois has gotten very worse. And those of you watching Illinois now, you know, along with me, you know, are probably very sad to watch this self-destruct. I mean, Illinois still hasn't balanced its budget for last year. They're facing large-scale layoffs in faculty. There is no strategic plan for how to cut. Institutions have been reorganized. The system of system has been dismantled. And we point to that as one of the key reasons why performance has changed, because then, of course, the funding changed in Illinois. And so then the institutions were organized around the two largest research sectors, and it became a sort of winner-take-all scenario. They failed to fund the MAP program, the Monetary Assistance Program. Illinois had one of the best financial aid programs in the country, and the funding for that has declined over time, so that Illinois' performance in terms of opportunity for people to enroll in post-secondary education, for them to progress, transfer, and complete, has taken a sharp decline. And, you know, the backdrop of all of that has been significant corruption in state government. I think when we were there, the second governor was being indicted and convicted and imprisoned for corruption. So when you don't have a functioning state government, and when there is not trust in state government and among institutions, some kind of ongoing communication, these things that have been stable for very long periods of time can decline very quickly. And that's, I think, one thing we should all be concerned about, is how fragile these our institutions are and our relationships are, and how important they are to pay attention to. So that's a very quick story. I want to talk about Maryland, which is a bit more optimistic. And our title for Maryland case study was Much Accomplished, But Much at Stake. Maryland had relatively high performance in higher education. They attract a very well-educated population due to their proximity to Washington, D.C., and to a knowledge-intensive economy in that area. The big challenge in Maryland, of course, is Baltimore. And we found a theme running across our case studies that every state, within every state, had regional challenges that state policy wasn't sufficiently able to address, particularly finance policy. And so states really have to think about that. Maryland had, you know, in terms of all the states we looked at, I thought the most thoughtful and strategic finance policy in place for higher education. And this was put in place right before the recession, which is interesting. They had a funding commission. It was called the Bohannon Commission, named after a senior senator in the state. And a very forward-looking and progressive plan for funding higher education. They were very worried about the volatility that Jane talked about, all the states having more volatility because our economy is changing, and during the down times, higher education taking such a hard hit. So with support of the business community, The people in Maryland voted and to create a corporate business tax and put that into a public endowment that could only be used when state revenues were going down for higher education. And it would be, you know, would have legislative oversight. So that was a really very important step that had business involvement and widespread public support. The second thing they did in Maryland is they froze tuition for about 5 years. And during that time, as the Bohannon Commission reviewed, you know, the whole finance structure, they decided that they were going to link tuition to growth in median family income in the state. Okay, that's a big step. So you link tuition to the realities of families that you have to serve within your state. And it does, you know, of course, limit revenue, but it was a state commitment. At the same time, the state said, we're going to get all of our institutions to a level of funding of the top five states. We want to be internationally competitive. And our state is going to make a commitment over time, and they had a plan over time to get all their public institutions to the top 5% of their peer groups. There was one other piece. Oh, they instituted a robust financial aid program after the late Senator Pete Rawlings to support student financial needs, students who still weren't able to pay the high cost of tuition. And this was made possible by a legislature and a governor that could talk to one another, that had very constructive relationships. It doesn't mean they never disagreed, because they certainly did. Very constructive relationships with the University of Maryland, led at that time by Britt Kerwin, a very effective both educational and political leader, who was willing to take a very serious look at his own institution and make cuts where they were needed, and to engage in this process with the legislature and the governor, and build up trust over time to the point where they could get to this finance commission and put this plan in place. Now, even during the recession, they were able to move forward on some of these recommendations. For instance, the corporate tax. They were putting money into the rainy day fund. It wasn't a lot because we were in a recession, but they knew over time the economy would come back and it would grow. So I haven't been back to Maryland in a year and a half, and I would like to go back and see what the status of this plan is. One of my concerns in Maryland is all of, this whole finance plan is highly dependent upon relationships, and maybe that's always, we're just going to have to live with that. But there have been changes in leadership in Maryland, and it would be interesting to see if they are on the same trajectory that they were on at the same time, at that time. The final state I'd like to talk about is Texas, and we call that Hard Choices Ahead. And those of you that know about Texas know that there is no other state in the country where local control is more important than in Texas. And the legislature is the most powerful body in Texas. The legislature has more power than the governor, the Speaker of the House, is the most powerful person in Texas, and the legislature actually presents a state budget and the governor reacts, whereas in strong governor states, it's the opposite direction. Now, the governor still has significant power, and when we were there, Rick Perry, who was the governor, was very strategic about board appointments to public boards of higher education, and that's how he exercised some influence. And most notably, the firing of Bill Powell from the university, UT Austin, but doing some other things. But Texas developed, the business community in Texas took a very activist role in addressing higher education. And they worked with the Texas Higher Education Coordinating Board, which again is one of the stronger coordinating boards in the country, to develop a plan called Closing the Gaps. And Closing the Gaps identifies very specific goals in the state for reaching certain levels of education attainment. It also has some aspirational goals that I think are in conflict with the education attainment goals. But everybody that we talked to in Texas knew about Closing the Gaps. They knew about where the state was in relationship to those goals. Every year, the legislature held hearings on it. They revised the goals. So everything about Texas is about closing the gaps. Having said that, they've made pretty slow progress improving levels of education attainment and increasing access and improving completion rates. But there are a number of important finance issues that surfaced in Texas. And one is who sets tuition and makes those decisions, both for the community colleges and the public four-year sector. And the next issue is the funding of universities the state has anointed to become research-intensive institutions. And so the first, in terms of tuition, the community colleges, which educate nearly 60% of the population in Texas, those students begin in the community colleges, are all locally controlled. And so tuition is set by local service areas. And local service areas, a student may not be able to get a course in his or her community college in the service area, so they want to go into another service area to take a community college course. They can pay up to as much as 50% more in tuition to do that. And Texas has a very weak, by the way, state financial aid program, so there's not a lot of money to help students cross service areas to do that. And these, you know, tuition levels are determined by the willingness of the public to tax themselves to keep tuition low. And of course, the service areas that don't have enough programs are service areas that are very poor. So it's the very students that have to cross the lines and go into another district that get the higher tuition charge in Texas. So it makes for very uneven levels of opportunity in this state to even enroll in post-secondary education. When we were there, the state, prior to our visit, the state had funded instructional costs at the community college at a level of 50%. After the recession, that funding was wiped out completely. Now the local service areas have to even pay for instructional costs. So there was no way to equalize opportunity because the state had really pulled out of their partnership with the locales, the place where most students have to start their education, and certainly most poor students and most students of color. And so that is a huge problem in Texas that nobody seems to be willing to address at all. And just an interesting statistic about Texas is 30% of Texas families, a full third, make $30,000 a year or less. So you think about that. You think about the future of the state. Now, it's not as bifurcated as California, where you have the very rich and the very poor. But Texas has a very large concentration of people at the bottom. And how it is going, and the state has no income tax. And so it has some structural problems that it has to address. So how it will provide opportunity and how it will, in fact, reach the goals articulated in Closing the Gaps is a real mystery to me. One of the issues that we challenged Texas on and got a lot of pushback on is, in order to get the Closing the Gaps plan passed through the legislature, there were powerful legislators in certain parts of the state, California can relate to this, that insisted they have a research university in their backyard. And so Texas decided they needed seven more R1 research universities. And so that was passed as part of the plan to close the gaps. And we describe that as one of the big policy trade-offs that Texas was making. You know, where are you going to invest limited resources, even if they had an income tax, with a population that poor? You know, they'll generate some money, but they're not going to be able to pay for seven more research universities. Well, most of you may know that University of Texas and Texas and A&M have a public endowment from vast tracts of land of oil and gas, and so they have the largest public endowment in the country in terms of a university, because the emerging institutions, you know, couldn't benefit from all that money. There was another public endowment, but that public endowment was funded through annual state appropriations, and it used to go to teaching institutions to help them, you know, work on their mission. So that public endowment, through a referendum process, and, you know, everybody in California is familiar with what happens when you put things like that into that. That was repurposed to be targeted to support these seven emerging research universities. Well, lo and behold, when you know, in the last month, it was announced that three more Texas institutions had been reclassified as R1 universities. And I will tell you that the reason that Texas believes they need this, everybody we talked to said, well, you know, California has nine. And, and not realizing the enormous amount of money it takes to fund research, not acknowledging how much history and time, you know, California had to build up this capacity. Texas thinks it will charge in, and they may do it, in fact, and they could do it, but they will do it at the expense of providing educational opportunity for low-income and minority students. So those are three stories that I can give you examples of that we told. And of course, you know, the themes that we came up, leadership matters in every state. And leadership is really, you know, often about how you use the policy tools at your disposal, and particularly how you use finance policy to get things done. And the optimization of system capacity, we think, matters too. How states organize these structures of higher education really intersects with finance, and we have to think more clearly about that. And then understanding how finance policies play themselves out in very different contexts is really important, because one finance policy for one state is not the same, will not have the same result in another. And so you really, context is paramount in this type of work in thinking about state. So I think I'll end my comments there.
Okay, while Jane and Joni focused on the external, I'm gonna focus on the internal and very internal. I'm gonna look at cost and capacity in the instruction and learning. So one of the big drivers now that people are thinking that we're going to use to solve the cost capacity issue in teaching and learning in higher education is
technology.
And there are lots of theories about how technology, what aspect, what affordance of technology is going to fundamentally transform the teaching and learning process. So I speak with lots of groups, and I always am interested in, and people, everyone has an opinion about what about technology is gonna transform us. So I'm just wanna take a poll here in the room first, so I kinda know who I'm speaking into. So the three things, I'll give you three choices, and then I'm gonna ask you truly to say which one you think it is. So be ready, listen. Okay, so the first one is the most obvious one, access. Convenience. It's what made MOOCs powerful, right? With a computer, you can access an educational experience anytime, any place. Access and convenience. The second one, usually people come up with after I've been talking for a while, because it's where I focused a lot of my energy, which is there are things we can do instructionally with a computer that we just couldn't do in the traditional face-to-face classroom. With a computer, we can do really robust simulations. We can show students things at microscopic levels or at macroscopic levels that we couldn't do in a traditional classroom. We can have students engage in things, like if I'm teaching engineering and I'm trying to teach you how to build a bridge, I can actually let you build a bridge. And you can build a bridge, and it can collapse, and nobody gets killed. But you can learn something from that. So this simulation capability of the technology. The third one, which has been more recent that people talk about, is connection. It's not that you're just holding a computer and it's you and the computer interacting, but that computer connects you to other learners, to other resources, to the world. So those are the three things I'm going to ask you to vote on. Access and convenience, the simulation capabilities, or connection.
And the vote means you we'd like it?
So I'm going to ask you to raise your hand which one you think. If you're a betting person and you say, Candace, I'm putting my money down on which of these things is really going to help us transform teaching and learning. Okay? So, get us out of, we're talking about cost and capacity. Which one of those things is really going to help us address this dual challenge of cost and capacity? Okay, first, access, and you only get one vote. Access and convenience. Okay. The simulation capabilities, things you can do with a computer that you can't do in real life. Okay. Connection, the connectivity. Okay, it's pretty even distribution here. Okay, so to your point, Candace, you're in a graduate school of education. What are you doing giving us crummy multiple choice questions? So how many of you wished I had said all of the above? How many wished none of the above? Yeah, okay. So you're right, it was a crummy, it's just to get a temperature taking. I wasn't testing your knowledge. But I actually agree with the none of the above, because I think all of those things are important. But I do agree with none of the above, because I think the real power in these technologies is what Google has already figured out. It's what Netflix has figured out. It's what Amazon has figured out. The power in these technologies is not using them to push stuff out, but to push it as far as the interface. Because in the interface, if we structure it right, we can observe the learner. Now, you know, Amazon, Google, they're observing us all the time in their interfaces. My son actually works for LinkedIn, so I know they're observing us all the time in their interfaces. And they're observing us for what reason?
Money.
Yeah, money, but the causal chain has a step in between. It's not observe money, it's observe. Learn about the user.
Right.
Both learn about the user, the individual learner, so I can personalize the experience to you, but learn about the user in general. That's the power of the data collection. And so you might be thinking, Candace, it's kind of creepy that you're talking about doing that to our learners, our precious learners. But I'm not thinking about them as consumers. I mean, Amazon, Google, they're trying to see us better as consumers so they know how to sell to us better. But if you take that idea and you say we're just trying to understand the learners better as learners, both individual learners, so I can understand where you are in your learning trajectory so I can better support you, but also learners in general, meaning the science of learning. How does learning happen? And how can we use that information to continuously improve how we do instruction? That's the power. And what makes me crazy, as if any of you who read the recent article where I think I kind of went on a little bit in the Chronicle, is what makes me crazy is the degree to which we are outsourcing the development of those technologies and the development of the data modeling that we're using to explain our learners to us. Like it or not, these technologies are going to become a core part of the teaching and learning process in higher education. They have to. All of the great information that Jane and Joni just shared with us, this cost and capacity linking, tells us our old tools, our old processes don't work. They don't work to meet. I mean, David started us off this morning talking about the diversity of our learners. That's the wonderful thing about higher education, is we not only have way more learners than we used to have, but they're amazingly diverse. Racially, ethnically, gender, age, sexual identity, sexual orientation, culturally, you name it. There are many dimensions of diversity. There's also diversity in their background knowledge, in the skills they bring to our classrooms, and even in their goals, why they're in higher education. There's diversity in the attributions they make, how they make meaning of the learning experiences we're constructing for them. And all of that diversity and all of those students, the old way of doing things, it won't work. It's unfair to us to ask us to attend to that much diversity with that many more students with the old tools and technologies. So we're gonna have to change our processes, and the technology will enable us to. And here's how. And this gets to the main theme of this conference. What is particularly amazing and great and unique about research universities in transforming or changing teaching? Okay, so here's how we all do research, right? We all do research, and we're used to this sort of what I would call linear technology transfer model, where in engineering, we do research so we understand better how to build bridges, and then we publish it or we put the principles out, and some industry picks it up and builds bridges. So I would call that the linear technology transfer model. It's the one we're all used to. It's suboptimal. It's suboptimal because you've disconnected research and practice. And so you're always in this place where you're doing research, trying to understand things, throwing it over and hoping the practitioners understood what your research was, implemented it, and then it applies to the real world. There's no feedback loop, or that feedback loop is really slow. The advantage we have, places like Berkeley, is that the research and the practice is co-located. So we no longer have to put up with this suboptimal linear technology transfer model. What do we do instead? And the technology enables that. So we can have the people that are teaching biology co-creating interventions in the technology with the learning researchers. So why don't students understand equilibrium? Well, you know, the biologist or the chemist has some ideas about what equilibrium really means. The learning researcher has something to know about how conceptual structures change. Put them together, design an interactive learning experience that both supports learners to get equilibrium, but also gives us insight, collects data to give us insight into how that conceptual change happens. We're both simultaneously improving the learning experience while we're making progress on our fundamental understanding of human learning. And we get very rapid feedback loops, research to practice, research to practice, research to practice. And we're in this amazing, we're the only sector, really, in the world that has that opportunity. And so I guess my main point is to solve this cost capacity problem, what we need to do, I agree with you, there's fundamental restructuring. One of those is the relationship between learning research and teaching practice in our institutions. And the other change that needs to happen is We can't do this alone. The old model of having an individual faculty member or an individual department or even an individual institution create the curriculum and the technology for their students, that model's not going to work. You need to find collaborators. And that could be peer institutions. It doesn't matter, because the amount of resources that it takes to design these environments well, the amount of expertise it takes to design them well and to analyze the data that's coming off of them and get that cycle is more than any individual institution, even the one the size of Stanford and the wealth of Stanford has. So the other piece is that the models that we create, this is the other fallacy, is people think, oh, these personalized and adaptive learning technologies that the external commercial providers are creating, we'll just let them do it because, well, they know what they're doing. It makes me crazy because, so in any other context, put your academic hats on. If someone came to you and said, okay, I've got this process that's going to collect this data, make a prediction, just trust me, it works. Just trust me, it works. Would any of us in any other context say, think about your own discipline, oh, okay, you know, that's alchemy, it's not science. And we need to submit these modeling approaches to the academic scrutiny that we know work. Peer review, transparency, challenging it. So I would submit to you, do not outsource this. Or if you're going to outsource the design and the modeling of the technology, insist on being able to peer review it. And you just don't accept that the way the model's working are neutral, because they will reflect either the biases of the person who developed them, or they'll reflect, if they're completely machine generated, they'll reflect the performances of the population from whose data they collected to build the model. So if the model was built on a population of students that looks like this, and your students in any of those dimensions of diversity we talked about don't match that model, then it'll be making predictions which actually don't match the students that you're trying to get information about. So my main goal is don't outsource this. This is our moment in higher education to actually take advantage of one of the things that we have, which is the co-location of teaching and research.
We do have up to half an hour for questions and discussion. And Steve, do wait for the mic, and then it will come, and you will ask.
So, Jane, I'm hoping that you can be a little more specific about what you mean by a cost-effective curriculum, or perhaps there are a number of different scenarios for that concept, but give us a little more concreteness about that.
Sure. I think that a cost-effective curriculum is one that is built around learning sequences and progressions and robust student learning that proceeds across topics. So it's you imagine a progression of what you learn in course A leading into course B. And students who are cohort scheduled to move through a well-designed curriculum in a way that is you know, quite intentional and thoughtful. So letting students opt out, of course, but the idea about what's the best way to learn and what's the best sequencing and how should courses connect to one another that produces robust learning, where students are learning, you're studying alike topics at the same time and not picking up the course that you need for something later in the process. So I think that we know something about sequencing of courses and optimum learning, and we don't think about the resources associated with it. If you designed certainly lower division, but also upper division around some of those kinds of concepts and scheduled your classes appropriately and staffed them appropriately and got students into that, that's a lot cheaper than the random selection of figure it out. We have a cafeteria approach. We expect the students to know not to take all the Jell-O cubes before they get to the protein. We need to be thinking about the presentation of courses in a way that makes good sense and produces good curriculum. And when you do that, it's actually cheaper because you have fewer undersubscribed courses. You're getting students through classes on a more timely fashion, less likelihood that they're going to need to go an additional year or two in order to get the classes they want. So it's more cost-effective for the student, more cost-effective in terms of learning.
Yeah, our mutual friend, Bob Zemsky, used to say that general education curriculums or required courses are more peace treaties than they are reflective of some kind of design centered around the student.
That's exactly, yep.
Well, what a knockout panel. Thanks a lot. That was really, really great. Candace, in light of your colleagues there on the table, you got any nifty ideas about how we're going to pay for all of this wonderfulness you're prescribing?
I think some of it is looking at how you're spending your resources now and seeing how you can rebudget if you acknowledge that these kinds of investments over the long term will support the new business process of teaching and learning. That's one way. The other way is... there are a couple ways. Another way is if the federal government recognized this as a significant challenge into which they could invest, like a DARPA-level investment of creating the infrastructure, the data infrastructure for supporting the kind of robust data collection and gathering and scientific discovery, thinking of it as an infrastructure for science. The third way, and this is one I imagine one of my colleagues might actually talk about, is governance of the new capital that's coming into the space. There's huge investment that is happening right now in the ed tech sector, especially around here. And one of the things that concerns me without any kind of governance structure on that now is that I have a lot of friends that are venture capitalists, and they look at a 30 times return on investment. That's what they're asking for in their investment. And so there is a narrative out there which is giving this to the private sector is what will drive innovation. But one of my former colleagues at Carnegie Mellon, Herb Simon, who was fundamentally an economist, talked about a theory of satisficing to the market. And in a market where what's winning right now, what the goal is right now is market share in that sector. It's not profitability. None of these VCs are looking for an immediate profitability in the ed tech sector. What they're looking for is market share. And so if you're trying to get market share, you're going to just drive your product to how it's going to be most purchasable, most usable to the sort of median of the market. And so if you put that together, that's not a recipe for innovation. That's a recipe for a couple things. One of them is we run the risk right now of tooling into these systems the norms that are just going to reproduce or exacerbate inequality, not fundamentally change it. So I think there, if we're going to look to the private sector to fund this, to govern this new capital, we need very different regulations and rules about how that capital is introduced into our sector.
Hi, yes. I'm Barb Bickelmeyer, and I will actually be presenting this afternoon about affecting change, and I cannot thank you enough for the setup to some of that. And I greatly applaud you, Candace, particularly in that comment, because I worry as public institutions that we are actually contributing to our own demise when we take what is going to be our core mission and contract that out for a profit. So thank you for bringing that up. To that end, though, I think one reason why institutions do that is they're looking to get ahead very quickly, and they're looking for the expedient answer, and they're doing that because of faculty reticence and particularly driven by existing promotion and tenure processes. So as you think about cost and capacity, I've thought a lot about change, what keeping tenure means, and yet how it can become more flexible in order to improve cost and capacity. What all do you see and think, and what is your guidance for how that combination impacts our ability to move forward.
You just replay your question and say that's what you need to do. My notion that what gets in the way of restructuring costs are our embedded notions of what quality means, and what that means is a very faculty and tenure-centric model, and it doesn't. We talk about having a bundled faculty role. Let's not kid ourselves. We've already unbundled it. We just call them adjuncts. You know, over 60% of the courses are being taught by people who are on something other than tenure track. Actually, it's more than 60%. So we have a system that is fictive. It's being maintained on policies that we're no longer even carrying out. So. What does good look like? Well, we ought to be thinking about that very differently. You know, it is possible to have high quality without having the same progression of faculty and staffing patterns that we evolved in 1945. But it needs to be done.
Yeah, the other possibility is for states to enter this market in a very different way with their money. And part of that is through incentives for institutions to do things differently, like maybe invest in some of the types of things that Candace has talked about, because that may create some incentive then to change faculty reward structures. But states have to intervene. I mean, you know, what always struck me about being in California when I was here is just the across-the-board subsidy that each sector would get that was never questioned, the different amounts between each sector. And we said, okay, that's for your mission. And we would do it across all faculty without any thought about effectiveness, effective programs, strong programs versus weak programs. And and leaders avoided those hard discussions then, because the state sort of set that in motion. And so I think states have to find a way to enter the market on behalf of learners in more creative ways.
I have to say, but when states try and do that, it's frequently not welcomed. It's the institutions want to see, in this state and others, I've seen the same thing, the effort to put some money out for supportive innovation and to incent change and to provide opportunities to shine lights on things that institutions are doing well. And the institutional response is, we want our base budget restored. We know what innovation looks like. You don't know what innovation looks like. Give us our base. So I think that there's it's hard for states to know how to intervene in this in a way that's appropriate. I do worry a lot that there's a greater fissure that's developing than I'd like to see between the institutional notion of what's in the institutional interest and the growing public concern mm-hmm. about the quality and value of higher education. And if public policy decision makers lose trust in the decision making of the people inside the institutions, that's not a good thing. And I don't think it's a good thing if state policy people substitute their own judgment right. for ideas about curriculum and how students should be taught. And California is not the state that scares me about this. But go to Louisiana, look and see mm-hmm. what Bobby Jindal wants to do with teaching and learning. It's not a pretty picture. So I think we need to be thinking about how people within institutions step up to public responsibilities and not expect the state to figure it out.
Okay, let's go back to the rear row over here.
Just to follow up on that momentarily, if you're not watching Missouri, the state of Missouri, and the University of Missouri system, where I happen to be working at this moment in time, I do think it's leading all conversations at this point about that point, about institutional leadership versus legislative and governmental leadership. So it's a story to be told.
Yeah. Now over here.
Thank you. Jason Lane, a Vice Provost for Academic Planning at State University of New York, so the system level office. And SUNY is the largest comprehensive system of higher ed in the U.S., and so community colleges all the way through. Three AAU institutions, and we're really trying to think differently about how do we harness the capacity of all those institutions and serve students across the board. One of the things I think is often missing from these conversations is that we are still so very much focused on the institution as the unit of analysis, yes, as opposed to how students are experiencing, yes, higher education. And so for SUNY, as an example, over half of our students, about 54% in any given year, who graduate from a baccalaureate program have attended at least two institutions or more. Right. You know, even Cornell and Buffalo and Stony Brook, we see about a third of the students who have actually attended more than one institution. You know, the master plan here was based on the idea of transfer. But we still very much focused on the student experience as being an institutional one, as opposed to one in which students are trying to navigate a system that's very, very complex to amalgamate credits across an entire set of institutions and then try to get a credential at the end. And I wonder to what extent you've thought about this, the role systems might play in trying to mediate the changing ways in which students are experiencing higher education, as opposed to the way institutions see themselves as being really the primary unit of analysis for delivering education.
Yes, I've thought about that. Let's see. I think you're right. I think there's a huge opportunity to use systems to create better synergies across institutions and to look holistically at student success and to remove barriers to student transitions. I don't think the systems we've got, we gotta get Judd in on this one too. I don't think the systems we have are by and large well structured to accomplish that. I'm a great believer in systems in higher education, and I think we need better ones. I think that many of the systems we have are still set up and to be the buffer between the state and the institutions, to stay out of the business of anything that gets close to academic policy. Their job is to get money from the state and pass it out and keep the Board of Regents at bay. I think the state agency model and the big system administrative model doesn't make sense in this environment. I think we need to simultaneously decentralize some things and re-centralize at a policy and student success focus. And the systems ought to be laboratories for effective practice and an understanding of where the intersection is between resource use and effective student learning outcomes. They have access to the best data systems in the world, but they don't. Well, actually, they have access to the worst data systems in the world. They have potentially they could get their hands on some very rich information that could be fed back into being a teaching and learning tool within the institution. So I think systems, yes, are the opportunity for this. As they're currently structured, they don't have the people to do it, and they don't have the credibility to do it, not to mention power.
Just to add on that one, there are, of course, many different types of systems. And you would think, in principle, that a system that was made of quite disparate array of institutions would be more able to do what Jason is asking, more able to facilitate multi-institution education. My experience so far is that that doesn't really happen, that when you get a system that is composed of all kinds of levels of higher education, articulation and transfer are still great problems. So it may be that the issue just doesn't get approached as a systems engineering type of problem that it really is and needs to be addressed as.
Blend that with the stuff I'm talking about. If you had it, then if you use the system as the organizing collaboration vehicle, and you got the R1s and the teaching colleges and the community colleges co-creating, like take a topic area, take introductory chemistry, get the faculty across those institutions to co-create with the learning researchers and the software engineers and the data analysts to co-create the educational technology that they're going to use to support the teaching of introductory chemistry. So that they're agreeing on what does competence look like when a student completes introductory chemistry, and then share the data systems and the modeling of the student knowledge state, then you'd have much more comfort, if you will, when a student went to the community college and did their intro chem course there and transferred to the four-year institution. Both the student and the faculty could have more comfort that student has the same sort of foundational baseline knowledge they need to be successful in the follow-on class, building back into Jane's idea about a coherent sequenced curriculum. You're talking about having to have a coherent sequenced curriculum across multiple institutions. And so I think that you're not going to get that unless you have the faculty at those institutions co-creating it.
So if I just let me follow up, we've done that actually now. We had 1,000 faculty in an online environment came together and created the only multi-directional transfer framework in the country.
That's different. A transfer framework is different than co-creating the actual educational technology.
Well, we're getting there to the point where we have shared knowledge about what the base looks like, and it will transfer anywhere in the system. So we're trying. We are not all the way there, but we're trying to bring faculty together to do what you're talking about.
Yeah, no, that's a good step. But what you're talking about bringing faculty together, I would submit, is different than what I'm talking about. It's a good first step. Just getting agreement on. What topics are even in an introductory chemistry course, but then to go the next level down to say, what is the competency that a student would be expected to be able to demonstrate, and how do we know, and what's an acceptable level? Building those agreements, and then what are the measurement instruments from the student's interaction in the environment that will create a believable evidence trail to us that I will accept that your student who took intro chem in your class over there is as prepared as if they'd taken it from me. That's the next level that you need to get to, I think. And I'll tell you, because I've led those kinds of conversations with groups of faculty from multiple institutions, and just having that conversation is valuable in and of itself. But if you have it in the abstract, it goes nowhere. But you have it as a design conversation where everyone's focused on this thing we're all trying to co-create and we've all committed to use, that changes the dynamic off of this abstraction. It also feeds back into the fundamental research approach that our faculty use, which is, okay, we created this thing, we've now created a hypothesis. Our hypothesis is this interactive activity that we've created is going to move students from here to here. Let's run the experiment, meaning we'll all have our students use it while we're trying to teach them it, and then we get the data back to see, did it work? Didn't it work? How do we need to refine it? And it sets up a continuous improvement process that is more in line with the research side of the house. So you're not asking faculty to turn on and turn off different parts of their brain.
There's one asterisk I want to stick on here, and that's to introduce the word regional when we talk about this. I think that part of the problem with systems is that they're so abstracted and huge, and they're not tactile, and they aren't. They don't do a good job of translating to where people actually live. And certainly in most states, the actions at the regional level and the many of the educational attainment problems are quite different depending on the region. So getting the folks in San Bernardino and the Inland Empire talking to one another about what cross-sector student success looks like and figuring out how they might put together better one-stop shopping places to help students figure. Most students go to institutions within 20 miles of where they live. So we don't think enough about that. I mean, the LA Community College District today is bigger than the entire state of California educational system was when Kerr put the master plan together. And we still are trying to do it with the same organization charts, and it doesn't work.
Steve Bradigan.
So I have another just an observation that the state of Florida has common numbering across the community colleges, teaching colleges, and the research universities, and that without quality control doesn't really mean that much. Yeah, but right. It would be a way to have the discussions you're talking about, Candace, that would say what competencies do we want in these courses, and would begin to solve the articulation problem.
Yes.
One of the things we saw in some of the states that we visited was another way, in addition to the common numbering, is to have transfer by degree, because then naturally the faculty, well, not naturally, they had to make it happen. The 2 and 4 year faculty would come together in given content areas and agree on the kind of courses students needed to take in order to transfer. Now, presumably they agree on outcomes, but you never know.
Yeah. It often doesn't.
I mean, they're just deals.
It often doesn't get down into that level, and I ran into this a lot. I used to work, I still do a little bit in the field of introductory statistics teaching, and I would meet with faculty and students in community colleges, and then the four-year target transfer institutions, and you'd have students that would take an intro stat course at the community college, which are not taught in statistics departments because they don't have them. They're taught in math departments, so they took statistics the way a mathematics faculty member would think about statistics. So the focus in what they were asked to do was a lot of calculate, calculate, calculate. And so and the courses were hard, they were rigorous, and the students would put all of this time and energy and practice figuring out how to calculate the standard deviation. Okay, and they got an A, they were ready to transfer, they transferred to the four-year institution, they take on the follow-on course in statistics at the four-year institution, and nobody cares if they can calculate the standard deviation because we have statistics packages that do that. What they care about is, can the student recognize when calculating the standard deviation will help them make progress conceptually on the question they were trying to use the statistics to answer? So the competence, even though they all agreed this transfers, it all covers these topics, the central limit theorem, standard deviation, what they actually meant when they said the student was competent in standard deviation meant something very different at the community college than it did at the four-year college. And so where does that put the student who now is transferred in, is already perhaps feeling a little bit like a second-class citizen because they didn't start at the four-year, maybe having some social belonging issues, and they come in, but they got an A in statistics, so they're sitting there thinking, this one I'm gonna nail, and they are blown away. And that student isn't thinking, oh, the problem is that my institutions didn't really align on what they meant by my understanding standard deviation in introductory statistics. That student is sitting there thinking, I don't belong here. And if we talk about cost, that's the bigger cost to me, is the students that we're losing because we're not really attending to their experience and the meaning they're making out of the experience. Sorry, now I feel like I got as depressing as Jane.
Yes.
Yes, behind over here. I'm sort of putting these two conversations together. By the way, I'm Jen Stringer, Associate CIO for Academic Engagement here at Berkeley, and spending a lot of time thinking about learning data. And so that's the question that I'm going to go to. The question about how systems can support students as they move around, and I have what I call a boomerang baby who's been to four different institutions of higher learning in, 4 years. How does the learning data and putting learning data perhaps in the hands of the student themselves solve that problem that maybe institutions can't? And I guess I'm feeding you the answer of what I think, but I'm interested in what you all think. As do you feel like we're at a place where the systems, the technology systems, are actually going to be able to enable us to actually almost hop over some of the issues that you've been talking around system alignment?
I'm not sure. I'm still working on the question, so I'm
okay. So one of the things I heard in your question is, if we give the students the data, will that? I'm not sure what you mean. Maybe this is what you're struggling with,
yes,
too, Jane. What do you mean? What data are you talking about giving to the students?
So I'm wondering if the systems actually create a learning profile about the student that could actually pass from place to place, which would help with the alignment, so that that institution, yeah, would know statistics was taught in a different way, and that this student has this variety of skill set. And it's not about whether the curriculum's aligned, it's actually the students' information themselves would be telling the next institution, here's what this person knows, here's what they don't, here's how they learn best.
Yeah, yeah, I get it now. Yes, so I agree with part of it, and I don't agree with part of it. So the part that I agree with is this notion that as our learning experiences get more and more mediated by some kind of technology, the power of that is we're collecting all of this interaction level data about the student, and if we design it right, we can make really good and accurate predictions about the student's knowledge state on whatever we've articulated. But that's a design question. So what I worry a lot about is we're collecting all of this data about learners and making predictions about their success or their knowledge, but we're not really checking back. Are those things that we believe are markers of competence and success, are they really accurate? You know, we have a little accuracy problem here. And that's what I worry about outsourcing the building of those models, because we care passionately about are the way we're modeling that interaction. It's not like, oh, interaction data, magic knowledge about the student. There's a whole step in between there about what data do we collect, how do we model that data, what factors do we consider when we're modeling the data, how do we weight those factors. All of those are judgment calls. And they're active areas of research. And then even once we can make a prediction, what of all of that stuff we could predict is important to communicate out and to whom and in what form so it's actionable. So I agree with your point that ultimately I think the power in getting the systems to be able to be these places where we could aggregate and solve the transfer problems is in the data collection and the being able to make accurate predictions about the student. And then some magic happens. That is, I think, where we need to focus is how to build what data to collect, how to construct the data systems, and how to model the data so that the information that we're generating from that data is actionable in a productive way. And I don't think the answer is, I mean, people say, oh, well, students should just own their own data. I don't think ownership of the data I actually don't even think it's important. Because once everyone knows that data exists, if you own it and you say, okay, I own it, I'm going to have the right to give you access to it or not, it's almost like a false sense of power. Because if I'm applying for a job and somebody wants to see my data record to see if I'm competent, and I say, no, I own that data, you can't see it, fine. The 29 other people who are applying for this job are letting me see it, so you go ahead and have that little power over your data. I don't care. I'm just not going to put you in the pool. So I think the questions about data collection and data governance are, we should be spending a lot of time and attention thinking about those things, because we want to maximize the sharing of data for scientific discovery and for really understanding learning and continuously improving our systems. But we also need to think about how we're collecting all of that data and what's going to happen to it, and how do we protect student and instructor rights.